so that Jesus will be made famous, so that people, Syrians and Indians and Cubans and the people across the street from us will say, wow, we want to know your God. We want to know that God. We see in you something that we don't have, and we want that. Or we want who? We want that person. Yes, Lord, do that, we pray. More and more, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Did you have something?
In the bulletin, did you mention anything about the street evangelism next Saturday?
I did.
You did.
Okay. I did. I think you were praying. Yeah. Next Saturday, 8:30, in Ocean View. See me for more details. Yeah. Okay. So today is a training time. I've had good friends lose their marriage because they didn't know how to do this. I've seen people in ministry lose their ministries because they didn't know how to deal with conflict. I've been in churches where there's been tremendous conflict, and I've seen even mature people not handle it well, and it's like Robbie Burns would say, everything went gang after a glay. You know, the best laid plans of mice and men go gang after a glay. That's Robbie Burns. You don't know Robbie, the poet laureate of Scotland? Unfortunately, he was a drunk, but he wrote some good poetry. And that was one of the pieces that everybody knows in Scotland. You've got to be Scottish, you know what you know. You probably know him from there. So God's commands and goals in this whole thing. All right, so here's the deal. When you start to get close to doing something really magnificent for God, the devil's going to use every little thing against you. Maybe you don't know that. But if you have any weaknesses, he's gonna try to exploit those weaknesses. So if you have a problem with being easily offended, guess what? You will be offended. If you have a problem with fears, your fears will suddenly appear. If you have a problem with lust, if you have a problem with whatever, the devil's going to try to tweak that because he's going to try to distract you or slow you down or do whatever he can because you're a threat to him. When you start to move towards revival, personal or corporate, on the mission field. Why do missionaries come off the mission field so much? Why do some missionaries? Because they can't get along with each other. It's not the pagans who send them home. It's the other missionaries who run them off the field. They can't get along with each other because the devil makes sure that every weakness in them is brought to the surface and is exploited. That's my understanding, why they come home. Sometimes they come home because they're really sick. But again, that's a demonic thing. Maybe they weren't taking care of their bodies and working too hard. Who knows? But when you get close to the things of God, the really big things of God, the devil will try to... So this past week, for the first time in our lives, we came eyeball to eyeball with a brown recluse in our bedroom. You know what a brown recluse is? It's a spider that can kill you. In our bedroom. Remember it? Jason's seen them. Yeah, so they're in Hampton Roads. Joan was bit by one in her house.
20 years.
Yeah. You know, the devil, one of the names of the devil in the Bible is Beelzebub. Beelzebub? What does that mean?
Lord of the Flies.
Lord of the Flies. So he has some sort of influence over bugs. And he will use bugs against you. I got ants in my crawling around my desk in my office now. First time I've ever seen so many ants all of a sudden. Like, you know, I don't know. So let's just take authority over all these little things. Let's take authority over bugs. All right, we're gonna shut that down right now. Okay. You'll claim that one? Yeah. All right. We're talking about bugs outside the body, but they can be in the body too. All right. Infectious bugs. So in Jesus' name, we stand upon the Word of God that says that we are more than what we think we are. Because God Almighty lives inside of us, and we have the authority of Jesus to speak the Word of the Lord against the schemes and arrows of the devil. So in Jesus' name, we take authority over every little creature that may be influenced by the dark side to come against us, either to frighten us or to hurt us. In Jesus' name, we command them to leave, to go. Get out. We evict you. You're trespassing on God's property, on our bodies, or our homes, or our land. Get out our land. Go, in Jesus' name, wherever he would tell you. And, Father, we ask you to rebuke Beelzebub, who's sending these kind of things, both infectious things, as well as things crawling around our house, or wherever, in Jesus' name, to get out. Go away. rebuke him, Lord, for these attacks against your people, our church, or any church that's being attacked because they're moving forward in the things of God. We thank you and bless you for your goodness and protection in Jesus' name. So God's goal in conflict for our lives, actually, is be at peace with all people. Be at peace with all people. Now, unless you're Pollyanna, you know that that's not easy to do. It's hard to be at peace with ourselves for a long time, let alone other people. No matter how much you fall in love with this person, how much you respect or whatever, eventually, if you hang around people, they will get on your nerves. That's my understanding of people. I will get on your nerves, or they will. So, but God says, be at peace. So how do we do that? Well, he breaks it down a little bit. He says, I want you to love your neighbor. Of course, Rhonda's got that neighbor who just got it into her face. Love that neighbor. And she did. She prayed.
Good job, Rhonda.
Yeah, she's back in the back. You didn't hear that with Julius. But this neighbor came up and was yelling at her so loud, her daughter was getting ready to call 911. Yeah, but she prayed and the guy came over and then tearfully apologized. But love your neighbor. Love one another. Talking mostly about Christians. Love your wife, to the husbands. This is Ephesians 5. And wives, respect your husbands. Speak the truth in love. Forgive as you've been forgiven. All right. So those are kind of some of the specific commands. And I think the love commands are the most challenging commands of Scripture. I think they're more challenging than do not steal, do not commit adultery, do not all those other things. I think the love commands are the hardest ones to obey. But how do you do this? Even in conflict.
Nope.
Surely God meant us to love others only when we're getting along. Joke, that's a joke. Number one, conflict is normal. We all probably have thought that thought, but I just want to make sure that you understand that if you're in a conflictual situation, it's not because the people, you or that person, is evil. It's just part of the human situation. We live in a world that's imperfect. So Job says, man is born for trouble as sparks fly upwards. Kind of the idea that when you're on earth, there's always going to be something going on that you ain't going to like. So that's because everybody is different. Conflict is not the problem. Everyone has disagreements. It's not knowing how to effectively disagree that creates difficulty. That's a big mouthful right there. Conflict is normal, but it's how you disagree that makes all the difference. So I'm going to try to train you as best as I can from my own experience and from some very good books that I've read recently. To say again, anger is normal. The Bible never says, don't be angry, ever. It does say over and over again, be slow to get angry. So it assumes you're going to get angry. That's the assumption. You are going to get angry at times. All right, everybody struggles with anger. God gets angry. If you read the Old Testament in particular, there's a lot of statements like that, but also in the New Testament. And Jesus, of course, with the whip of the temple, get out, you money changers. This is the house of prayer for all the nations. What are you doing? Get out of my house. Believers can be angry. It says that in Ephesians 4:26. Be angry, but sin not. Can you imagine the conversation of Adam and Eve the day after they got kicked out of the garden? Well, Eve, you're the one that gave me that apple. Well, Adam, you're the one with all the authority. You took it. You know. And they lived for 900 years? Whoa. when did that conversation go away? brave German woman. Anybody hear German? You would be proud. You know the brave German woman? She was in a balcony in the church in Wittenberg.
That was awesome.
Where Martin Luther put the 95 Theses, and to be politically correct, they invited a Muslim imam to come and say a prayer before this service. So he gets up there and starts going, to Allah in a Christian church. And this woman gets up and says, you should stop that. This church has been dedicated to the Lord Jesus Christ and you're praying to a false god. Stop that.
Amen.
She was escorted out, of course. But what a beautiful and brave thing to do. Inside of her, this righteous anger says, that is not right. This place is dedicated to Jesus. the only true God in your brain to a false God. Stop it. Well, I really admire her. And her anger was good anger. So be slow to get angry. Of course, it says that here in Proverbs, he who is slow to anger is better than the mighty, he who rules his spirit than he who captures a city. So you're better than Rambo. You're better than the most amazing warrior you can think of if you can control your spirit and be slow to get angry. It's a great character trait. God likes it. Anger is dangerous. Refrain from anger. It can only lead to evil. If you live in the angry zone, and some people really like to live in the angry zone, they think that's where they should live, it will lead to evil. I've known people like that. I had a guy work for me one time, and I don't normally have outbursts of anger, but it's like you get around those people, it's contagious. I had an outburst of anger with this guy. It was like I picked it up from him. Huh. That's the only thing I can think of, but he lived in the anger zone. Be angry, but do not sin, because if you let the sun go down in your anger, that is, you let it fester, stay in there, you will give the devil an opportunity. And that's not something that's very wise to do. If you don't forgive, your father will not forgive you. Again, not a smart idea. So anger usually leads to unforgiveness, and if you hold on to it, you're in trouble. The old sticks and stones lie. Sticks and stones will break my bones, but words will never hurt me. That is so untrue. Who's ever been hurt by something people said to them 30 years ago? Honestly, people can go through their whole lives and forget a lot of things, but remember something really evil or negative or destructive that was said to them decades earlier. Words can hurt is worse than stones. So anger is dangerous. Anger is a secondary emotion. Do you know what I mean by that? When someone gets angry, you or someone else, there's something else triggering that. There's something beneath there that's usually more vulnerable and tender. And that's the real issue. The anger is just the tip of the iceberg, as we see here. So anger is the tip of the iceberg, but these are a whole bunch of things that can cause the tip of the iceberg to pop up above the water. Grief, insecure, they're sad, they're worried, fear. Your kid runs into the street, he's almost hit by a car. How do you feel? You feel, and when that kid comes back to the house, you're angry. You almost got killed. Do you know what? I told you never to do that. Why are you so angry? Because you're afraid that you almost lost your child. Grief. Anger is one of the stages of grief. We all know that problem. Anything work?
Yeah, we get it.
Alright. See, it's such an important message, the devil doesn't want you to hear it. Alright, we'll go with that.
Yeah,
you got it. That's a really good slide to remember next time you run into somebody who's angry at you. Try to figure out which one of those things under the water there that they're feeling. And that's what you should focus on, not the fact that they're in your face. I don't know why that guy came up and got it Rhonda's face, but something was going on down below the water here. All right, good to know. So how do you respond to conflict and anger? All right, I'm getting a lot of directions here. My ways are not their ways. How do you respond to conflict and anger? How do you respond? There's two main ways that most people respond. Fight or flight. Who are the fighters here? I figured. Oh, really? I would have thought you would have been the other guy. Wow, fighter. Watch out. He knows karate, judo, and a few other Japanese words. So you want to duke it out verbally with them, or you want to just get away from it. I don't want to have to deal with this. And then there's the third way. You just want to, it didn't really happen. I don't see no evil, hear no evil. You just pretend it doesn't exist. That's the third way. All right? Are these good ways to respond to conflict? Well, sometimes. They all have their timing, but Generally, there's some other ways. This little video, I've edited it, but I think it says something important we all need to hear. We're going to roll that, hopefully the sound.
When we confront it, usually we're not sons. But what appears to us to be the radical selfishness, intransigence, or sheer nastiness of the partner, it is extremely tempting to react with equal force. We aren't, after all, a pushover. We've been hurt, and we must hurt back. We will make them suffer as they have made us suffer. There may be variations in just how we ought to inflict the suffering. Perhaps we'll do a lot of shouting, slam a door, or maybe we'll eke this one out with a sulk. But the underlying principle is the same. We've been hurt, and we have to punish. But at this point, we might ask ourselves what we're really seeking. After all, we're not trying to administer abstract justice or punish for the sake of it. This isn't a criminal court or the headmaster's office. What we're truly seeking in a close relationship is something much more touching. We want the other person to love us properly and to be kinder. That's why we're slamming the door. Surprisingly, almost the last thing we ever do when we've been very hurt is to say that we've been very hurt. It feels just too humiliating to reveal our wound to the person who inflicted it, to show ourselves as vulnerable in front of the very individual who, it seems, has unbearably abused our vulnerability. This is both hugely understandable and doesn't advance things in the least, because we're not in a relationship to be emotionally safe. We're there to find connection. An act of retribution, while it may give us a momentary impression of impregnability, never increases our chances of obtaining the love. We might consider a different and slightly paradoxical approach. We might, exactly at the moment when we've been wounded by our partner, instead of hitting back, make what we could term a dignified avowal of hurt and fear. Rather than get furious, we might attempt to register and get directly at what is ailing us through a twofold admission. We might say, firstly, I'm so hurt that someone I've put my emotional trust in should say or do that to me. And secondly, and this takes proper courage, we might add, I'm so frightened that I should be emotionally deeply exposed to someone who would appear to hurt me like this. This should give the partner pause for thought. One hasn't insulted them or hurt them back in the usual way, which is what typically blocks their ears and sets off a vicious cycle of attack and counterattack. We are being dignified and honest. We aren't lashing out, but nor are we begging. We are neither being very strong nor very weak. We're neither punching nor crawling. We're just standing still, admitting our genuine sadness, fear, and nakedness in a tone of marked self-possession. Too often, arguments become interminable and, to outsiders, slightly daft, because both people refuse to admit that they're sad, not mean. It isn't what time to leave for the airport or whose turn it is to do the dishes that's created the argument. It's that both parties are, in different ways, feeling unloved and misunderstood, but are refusing to say this in quite so many words.
I actually edited that. That was made for a gay couple, by the way, that video. But the principles in it are powerful. And if you've been married for a while, you know how powerful they are. Or if you've been in a close relationship with anybody in your family, mom, dad, other sisters, you eventually hurt one another, and you probably haven't done what they said. Wow, I'm hurt. And I'm afraid, too, because I'm so connected to you, and now you've hurt me, and I'm fearful of what that means for our relationship. Powerful words. Hope you'll think about them. We'll get more. So how to love during conflict. Make sure that you communicate two things to the person that you're in conflict with. Number one, you are important. Such a simple concept, but when you're in conflict with somebody, that's probably the last thing you want to communicate to them. You want to like punch them in the nose verbally or physically, or you want to get back, you want to punish, you want to shut them down, you want to prove who's right, you want to get the upper hand, whatever it is. But you really don't want to do that. Not if you want to be close to this person. Okay? Well, now we're talking about how to resolve conflict with people that you're in close, loving relationships with. Maybe another time we can talk about how to deal with when ISIS knocks on your door or something, but now it's different, all right? So communicate, you are important, and I respect you. If they don't hear throughout the whole conversation, I respect you, I respect you, I respect you, if the conversation will not continue to go well. You have to start with you're important, and then throughout it, the words, and your body language, your face, whatever, has got to communicate, I respect you. I don't agree with you, but I respect you. I'm hurt by you, but I respect you. I'm afraid for our relationship, but I respect you. It's got to be a constant theme so that you make the conversation over conflict safe. When you stop, when the conversation stops becoming safe for one or both people, then you're not going to go anyplace very healthy. You're going to end up in a bad conclusion, a bad destination. We all kind of know that, but I hope that's just kind of clarifying. You both have to be telling the other, you're important, I respect you, and we're safe in this conversation. So, let me just emphasize again, that don't flee conversation, you know, those 3 days of responding to conflict, fight, flight, or play dead. I'm recommending to you that you not flee from conflict in a close relationship, or that you play dead and just pretend it's not there. If you don't resolve conflict, it erodes trust and weakens a relationship. It happens in marriages and families, in churches, in government, between nations. It's all the same deal. If we don't resolve our conflicts, the relationship will be weaker. And if you process it, it shows that you trust one another enough to process, to talk about something difficult, and it keeps, and that you value the relationship enough to do that. Relationships at home or at work cannot flourish without regular, honest talk about conflicts.
Is this being recorded?
It is. It is. It's being recorded there, and Lord willing, back there. I see the red light. Okay, good. Yeah. So, okay. And I'll put it on the web here pretty soon. So, is winning an argument worth it? When we're hurt, when we're angry, it always seems, yeah, man. Why not? What a dumb question, right? All right, but you can win the argument, but damage the relationship. So, win argument, damage relationship, you know, which is more important to you? Hopefully, the relationship. This guy here. Here lies the body of William J., who died maintaining his right of way. He was right, dead right, as he sped along, but he's just as dead as if he was wrong.
Yes.
It's a piece of doggerel, as they call it. Kind of funny poetry. So you can be right, but in the end, you really lose. That's one. If you want enemies, excel your friends. Be better than your friends. If you want friends, let your friends or spouse, whatever, excel you. Let them look good. Let them be the hero. Let them be the important person. You can be that too, but make sure they know you feel that way about them. So God says, we have the wrong goal if loving and protecting our relationship is not our main goal in conflict. Again, just think about that. When I've been in lots of conflictual discussions. I don't think that has been my main goal all the time. I have been more concerned with defending my dignity and my correctness and my rightness and my right to be unassailed by the slings and arrows of outrageous fate or whatever.
Ego.
You know, ego, yeah. E-G-O, ego. Rather than focusing on protecting the relationship. It's an easy trap to fall into. And once you fall into it and you stay there a while, it's hard to dig your way out. Because by then you've done some damage. And that damage can take a while to undo. So, So always work for connection, not primarily for winning. Now, those of you who are fighters, you see those hands again? This is a hard challenge because you're wired to be competitive, to get that point, to, you know, make that touchdown, to, you know, get that job done. You're wired to get things done right and to be in charge and to, you know, to win. But in relationships, connection, the relationship should be of higher value, or else you're going to lose some of the relationship's benefits. So if needed, say the 9 hardest words in the English language. All right, what are they? Who knows the 9 hardest words in the English language?
I was wrong.
I am sorry. Please forgive me. No, the last is please forgive me. I was wrong. I'm sorry I was wrong. Please forgive me. 9 hardest words in the English language. And if you say them a lot in relationships, especially in families and marriages, it really protects it. It's like Teflon, you know? Teflon coating. So C.S. Lewis, I love this. Love is unselfishly choosing for another's highest good, even in conflict. So in conflict, we got a problem here. We disagree. You want this, I want that. You've done something to hurt me. I feel offended, I feel disrespected. But I want to go into that discussion, choosing your happiness. Unselfishly choosing your highest good. Now, who can do that without God's grace? It's not a normal human thing to think like that. But we can. We can think God's way. His ways are higher. This is how he wants us to think. To love like he loves. You know, when Jesus came down, when God sent Jesus, he wasn't trying to make himself feel good. He was choosing our highest good, and he was willing to pay a price for it. When he's hanging on the cross, and all these people are jeering at him, and spitting, and doing whatever they're doing to mock him, what does he say? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. So he's seeking, he's saying, he's concerned about their forgiveness, not his pain. That's God's love. That's how he wants us to respond. So protect the love connection. From 1 Corinthians 13, the love chapter. Love is patient, is kind, does not envy, does not boast, is not proud, e.g. ego. It does not dishonor others. Even in conflict, it is not self-seeking. Even in conflict, it is not easily angered. Even in conflict, and it keeps no record of wrongs. Even in conflict, yes. Right. Yeah, the women all say, oh no, really? It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Even in conflict. Thank you. So I'm going to give you about 20 different, very powerful and practical ways to deal with conflict. And I can print these up. The video will be online if you want. But these are, okay, first one, wait until your heart is right. When you get ticked, when you get upset, it's probably not a good idea to just blurt it out at the moment. Give yourself a chance to calm down. Be slow to be angry. Slow, 24 hours. Slow to be angry, and talk to God about this. Okay, God, what am I feeling? What's going on? What's beneath this anger that I'm feeling? The anger, remember, is the secondary emotion. Underneath that, I'm feeling hurt. I'm feeling disrespected. I'm feeling afraid. I'm feeling sad. I'm feeling abandoned. I'm feeling all these more tender emotions. What is that more tender emotion down there? And then, you know, think about that and talk to God about that. And then, after 24 hours, invite them to talk because, you know, you're so important to me. I need to talk to you about something to protect our relationship because you're so valuable to me. I want to do this so that we can have a good relationship. And right now, I'm feeling a little hurt about something. So that's the motivation. And that's a good thing to say. Please talk to me because you're so important to me. And then I would recommend, if you can, pray with them. Say, you know, I think we need God's help here, God's grace to hear each other well. So let's pray. And while you're praying, say something to honor them. Thank you, Lord, for my wife. Thank you, Lord, for my best friend here, and who's been there for me all these years. And I just pray that we can hear each other, communicate in a way that will strengthen and protect this wonderful relationship you've given us. Amen. Something like that. Focus on a shared win-win goal. All right, so this is really important. If you go for a win-lose solution, it's not going to work out that great. If your goal in the conversation is to win and they lose, then I wouldn't go there. We've all done that. I'm right, you're wrong. You know, this is my decision, not your decision. Whatever. But if you can think about a goal out of this that where they can be them and you can be you and it can be a win-win. There's all kinds of illustrations. Anybody ever had that kind of a conversation with somebody where you had a win-win goal? Like what? An illustration?
I have an international illustration.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Yeah, okay. So
international, all right.
Yeah, you have President Trump and Kim Jong-un, okay, and he showed him a video, and he said, this is what nuclear annihilation looks like. And then he showed him another video. This is what your coastline developed looks like between China and South Korea. And so he could win, get rid of his nukes, and have beautiful resort beaches.
All right. Kind of like good cop, bad cop.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, he said, if we go to war, it's going to look really bad. If we live in peace, then your country's going to be prosperous and
large.
Yeah, exactly. Well, yeah, that's not bad. So, and he probably said, and we want you to have this prosperity. We're a prosperous nation. We want to share our prosperity with you. But in order for that to happen, you'd have to lay down your nukes because that makes us feel unsafe. Something like that. So both countries want North Korea to be prosperous, right? Especially North Korea. So that's a shared goal. That's a win-win goal. All right. Very good. Thank you. Talk about your own mistakes first. Apologize. It's always good to do that, to humble yourself and to admit that you've made mistakes and you're not the self-righteous, high and mighty, you know, whatever. It disarms people. It's worked many, many times for me. Because I've made so many mistakes, I can identify with them. With most people's mistakes, too. You've done that? Well, hey, I did that a long time ago. So many times, I can't even remember. This whole sermon, I've made so many mistakes in not doing the things in this sermon. I totally, totally get why people do that stuff, why they don't do this stuff. Totally get it. So, secondly, start off with lots of honest secondary agreement. Now, you probably haven't heard this term, secondary agreement, before. We were taught it 40 years ago in a seminary class. So let's say we don't agree on how to spend the budget or where to go on vacation or how to, what else? What do we not agree on? All right, don't get the list out. But I can agree like this, say, well, I can understand why you would want to do that because why do you want to buy a lot of art supplies? Because art is really important to you. Now, we only have $100 and you want to spend $50 on art supplies. I can understand why you want to do that because art gives you joy and you bring joy to other people through your art. I really get that. So I'm agreeing at a secondary level. I'm not agreeing with her goal. Her main goal is to spend 50% of her income on art supplies. But I'm understanding. I understand why art is so important to you and it brings you joy and brings other people joy. That's secondary agreement. You're letting them know you understand the validity of what they're feeling. Not necessarily their solution, but the validity of their motivation for that solution. Does that make sense to you?
Would you call that compromise?
No.
No, we haven't talked about any sort of decision yet. All I'm saying is we're validating the motivation and feelings of the person. I want to spend my vacation with my in-laws. Well, I want to go to the woods and go hunting. Well, okay, that's two very different things. So, well, honey, I can understand. I can understand you love your mom so much, and your mom's been sick for a long time, and you want to spend some time with her. I can understand that. Yeah, you're just giving understanding, letting them know you understand. In other words, that their motivation for what they want is not crazy or stupid or evil. You're validating their motivation, validating what led them to make the proposal that you disagree with. Spending the week, your 1 week of vacation with in-laws versus 1 week in the woods, you know, hunting and fishing. Okay? That's not an uncommon thing for some couples.
What I found works, especially when you're talking to Christians, mm-hmm. is to establish that you have the same ground rules. We both want to honor God. We both have a foundation. We want to see Christ honored.
Right.
And we want to honor each other. It's so good that we have that.
Right.
So we can tackle this other.
There you go.
All right. You know, even if they're not Christians, you and I both have a moral framework, and I'm so thankful for that as we continue to talk.
Okay, you said it, and then said it better than I did. You want to establish common ground.
Yeah.
Whether it's agreeing that with their motivation, you want to honor your mom and dad. I do too. I just have this other desire to go hunting, but I think your mom and dad are great. You want to spend the week with them. I think that's a beautiful thought. I think it's a great consideration. So you build common ground. You build common ground also through apologizing. You feel like they've made a mistake that's hurt you. You know what? I have made that mistake or similar mistakes 1,000 times. I totally get it. Why it's so easy to end up there. You're building common ground.
This person may not even have that same framework. But if you honor their motivation,
right.
It'll kind of move them into that place of wanting to have that framework.
Right. And that's, when you honor their motivation, you're making them feel what?
Validated.
You're important. Yeah, making them feel validated or important. And showing them respect. Yeah. You're not diminishing or demeaning their value. In fact, you're doing the opposite. You're elevating their value because you agree with their motivation. Very important. And so secondary agreement has to do with that. Turn butts to ands. Oh, I'm famous for this. Oh my gosh, I know. Don't cheer yet.
Yeah, give her a mic.
You did a great job in your schoolwork, but your room is still a train wreck. What did you, Jennifer? You did this really good, but you're a wonderful person, but you're this, but you know those buts, right? And they just seem to, they just kill whatever you said beforehand. It's just, all they remember is what comes after the but. All right, so what if you did an and instead? You did great schoolwork, and with the talent that you showed in school, I'm sure that you will be able to do things at home just as well.
No, that's not what you do.
Okay.
That's not what you do. You reverse it. You can still use the but you reverse it. Your room was a mess, but I'm so proud of you and how you complete your homework on time and do well with your homework.
All right.
What follows the but is what's most important and is going to be remembered. So put the negative, if you have to, put the negative first in the but.
Don't say that negative.
All right, I like that. Do you like that?
Yes.
Your room is still an issue, but what you're doing in school is amazing.
Yeah.
Okay, that sounds good. All right, I think it also works to say you're doing great at school, and I can just see you have all the capability to do things at home just as well. And whatever you would attempt to do. And your assignments at work at school are so well done. I'm sure you can do the same at home. So it's kind of indirect correction. Whoops. You saw it. It was indirect. Yeah. Did that make sense to you? Watch the butts. Yeah. The love language of conflict.
Sorry.
Yeah,
why not record?
That's my
goal. Use I statements. What do I mean by that?
I mean
you make me angry. Every time you do that, I get depressed, or I get frustrated, or I lose hope, or I feel bad. You, okay? So why does it make the other person feel? It doesn't show respect, and it puts all the blame on them. I feel hurt when you do this or when you don't do this. I feel afraid when you do this or don't do this. I feel sad when you do this. So, number one, you're doing what the video said. You're pointing to the real emotion beneath the anger, the fear, the sadness, whatever it is. And then you're taking responsibility for that. I'm focusing on my feeling, not so much yours. So use I statements. Listen for feelings and facts and check out what you heard. This is something else we learned in seminary. So this is mainly for the guys. Guys tend to focus on the facts. Women focus on facts and feelings, right? So like in the Chinese language, they have tones. You can say one word with four different tones and it means four different things. Everybody, you all know that? Yeah, you know that, right. So, I can say, I forgive you. I forgive you. I forgive you! All right, there's a different tone there, right? And guys tend to not pick up on the tone or the feeling. They just look at the facts. Well, you said you forgive me. Yeah, but I was mad at the party. Didn't want to. You made me forgive. So it's good when you get into conflict to slow things down, and so tell me what you want to tell me, and she tells it, and then you feed back to her not just the facts, the words, but the feeling you've sensed behind it. Well, you said, I forgive you, but I feel like you were feeling angry and frustrated also when you said that. Is that true? Well, that is true. I was feeling forced into saying words I don't mean. Oh, well, let's talk about that. So, feelings and facts. And when you get into really tense conversations, tell the other person what you're hearing in both feelings and facts, and ask if it's accurate. Because you know when you get upset, sometimes you don't hear clearly. And also by feeding it back to them, you let them know you understand what they're trying to say. Or they can clarify what they really tried to say. Well, that's not what I tried to say. I tried to say this. Oh. Okay, so that's a helpful thing. Balance suggestions with honest praise. You know the old jelly sandwich thing? You praise them, you correct them, you praise them. If you want the best results, you're the best employee I've ever had. This particular area right here needs some work. Could you work? Pay attention to that. I'm so grateful to have you as an employee. You're a great hire. Okay, praise, correction, praise. It goes a little, you know, just a spoonful of sugar makes the medicine go down. The medicine go down. If you balance the sugar and the vinegar together, it goes down better. And it shows respect for the person. But it has to be honest. You can't make stuff up. It's got to be honest. Point people to the best version of themselves. Everybody here has a bad version of themselves and a good version of themselves. Point people to their best version. I know that you have it in you to do the most amazing work on this job. I know that you have it in you to be patient with the kids, even when they're going crazy all day long, because when I married you, I saw it in you. You're just an amazing person. Remind them of who the best version of themselves are, not instead of just pointing at the worst version. And people will live up to that. They'll try to live up to that. Ask them how it can be done better, rather than you telling them, well, we could do it. Again, show respect and say, well, how do you think we could make this decision better? What's a better process? Ways to love during conflict. Avoid criticism, respect. So, you like Fords, I like Chevys, all right? I'm going to try to sell you a Chevy. And you're ready to duke it out with me, Ford versus Chevy, or Volvo versus Chevy. Okay, all right? So So I don't, what I don't want to do, if I want to sell you the Chevy, is I don't want to criticize the value of Volvos.
Remind me that your daughter has $3,700 here.
Yeah. Yeah, my daughter bought a car and a Ford hybrid, and the one part cost $4,200 to fix it. So getting rid of that car. So if you say Volvos are blah 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 wonderful, I say, you know, I agree with you. They are amazing cars. They're well built, they're sturdy, they're rugged, they've got a great reputation. Volvo is a great car. So then are you gonna be defensive? No, you're not gonna be defensive. And so I say, and let me just tell you something about Chevys you may not know. He's going to listen to what I have to say about Chevy. He's not going to be defensive because I've agreed with everything he said about Volvos. All right? Honestly agree. But now I can tell you all about Chevys, and you may or may not buy it, but at least we're not, I didn't put you down for your beliefs. I didn't disrespect your sense of judgment by saying, well, only an idiot would believe that, you know, that or something like that. I validated your opinion, and I just shared my opinion. You may or may not buy it, but I've shown respect, and maybe at some point later, when you see the light, you might want to buy a Chevy. All right. That little thing there I got out of Dale Carnegie's book, How to Influence People and Make Friends. That book is phenomenal. Have you read that book?
Yes.
That book is, I mean, there's so many good principles for human relationships in there. Let them do most of the talking. Again, you're honoring them, you're respecting them, rather than you dominating the conversation, and you're trying to listen to them. Listen and let them talk. And look for areas of agreement. Refuse to be defensive. Boy, that's a big one. You know, sometimes people just can't hear you. They don't get it, even though you know you're right. It's okay. Let God work it out, sort it out. I mean, the Bible says if they take your shirt, what are you supposed to do? Give them your coat. So if your wife takes your shirt, so to speak, verbally, well, fine. I'll trust the Lord. Here. Yeah. Is there anything else you want to bring up? Get me on the other cheek? I mean, that kind of a, I don't care if you take advantage of the attitude in a close relationship. Goes a long way to protecting the relationship and trusting the Lord. So Rhonda there, she didn't punch the guy in the nose. She didn't call him a bunch of names. She just took it, went inside, and prayed. And the guy changed his mind.
But she did videotape.
She did videotape.
And she prayed.
Right, well, all right. But she didn't retaliate. Okay, she just thought she needed that for legal purposes. Okay, please be defensive. Promise to think things over and get back to them if it's that kind of a conversation. Show honest respect for their thoughts and set a date. Thank them for talking and set a date to get back together.
Whoa.
So that's the whole spiel. It's a lot of points, I know. But if you were to learn just one or two of those that you don't currently learn, you'd have better relationships with people that you really, really love that you're eventually going to be in conflict with. Believe me, you will. And that's how people are made. That's why God has all these commandments about be slow to anger and forgive, etc. So again, just to repeat, how to love during conflict. Make sure you communicate two things. You are important to me, and I respect you. And if I do that, you'll keep this conversation safe. And then you can come to a much better conclusion. All right? So that's pretty much it. Turn the sound up
right
there.
Do you really spend this much?
This is just a 1 minute thing that shows the value of relationships.
What are we gonna do?
What's it say?
those relationships are worth it. That's just a little video to remind us all that no matter what age, no matter who we are, close relationships make our life rich. Life, abundant life is all about abundant relationships with God and with each other. And so this training today was just to help you understand with more clarity on how to respond when you get your feelings hurt or somebody else does, because we want to protect the beauty, the life-giving beauty of close relationships, brother and sister, husband and wife, mom and dad, friends, close friends, neighbors even. You know, these are all precious. This is our life. Relationships are our life. Relationships with God, relationships with each other. So I'll give you 2 minutes. I know we're running over. 2 minutes to ask God this question and let him discourse your eyes and ask God, Lord, what are you saying to me today? As we play this beautiful love song. Is it there?
Yeah.
There you go. Here's Unchained Melody. 2 minutes, ask God, Lord, what are you saying to me today? For reminding us how precious relationships are and how important it is to protect them, even in the midst of conflict. I pray that you will continue to give us the heart, the mind of Jesus. Holy Spirit, teach us. Teach us the things of Jesus, how he loved, how he forgave. Teach us what the scriptures are telling us about speaking the truth in love, with respect, with unselfish love, seeking the other person's highest good in every conversation, especially in those intense conversations about hurt and conflict. Lord, teach us to be slow to be angry. And then when we are, to deal with it quickly and lovingly, respectfully, to protect our hearts, to protect our relationship, and to protect what you're doing in us and through us for the sake of the kingdom. Lord, don't let us miss relationships that are important to the kingdom just because we get our feelings hurt. Help us to work through things, not just for our sake, but for your sake. Don't let the enemy divide and conquer us in our homes, in our marriages, in our workplaces, wherever we go, Lord. We pray that we could Return good for evil, blessings for curses. Do good to those who despitefully use us. We'll love even our enemies, and certainly, Lord, to love those who love us with a very kind, patient, slow to anger, respectful love, speaking the truth in love. Thank you for this today, and God, thank you for loving us like that. That we have, I'm sure, disappointed you so much. We've made you feel sad. We probably hurt your feelings, if that's possible, because we've said we'd do things and we didn't. We've broken your commandments, even though we've said we wouldn't. And yet you continue to forgive, to love, to seek the best in us, to make us more, to lift us up higher and stronger than we ever could be. Thank you, God, that you love us that way and help us to love one another. And everybody say, amen. Amen. Well, thank you, church, for patiently...